Tonight, a proposal to rename the Uranora International Airport after Laverne Spencer in honor of a gold medal win at the Commonwealth Games. A call for politics to be left out of trade union affairs as the CSA gets set to elect a new executive. The Ministry of Health continues the steady transitioning of the Victoria Hospital to the Owen King EU Hospital. And a former Prime Minister challenges politicians to put nation building ahead of scoring political points. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polia. It is being suggested that the Uranora International Airport be renamed the Laverne Spencer International Airport in recognition of a gold medal win at the 2018 Commonwealth Games in Australia. The suggestion was made during a reception to welcome the athlete home yesterday. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
A former president and International Olympic Committee member has suggested that the Uranora International Airport be renamed to Laverne Spencer International Airport in recognition of a historic achievement at the 2018 Commonwealth Games. The 33-year-old high jumper made history on April 14, 2018, when she won the island's first ever gold medal at the Commonwealth Games. Mr. Richard Peterkin is recommending that a landmark fitting Spencer's achievement be renamed after her.
You understand that they're going to be knocking down this airport and building a new airport starting in July. I'm not sure where the money is coming from. But like everything else, we have run out of stadia to name after Laverne. We don't have any more stadium to turn. So my suggestion is that this airport become the Laverne Spencer International Airport. Doesn't that sound good?
A few years ago, the community of Babono renamed a driveway leading up to Spencer's home after her.
I don't think I have anything named after me except, you know, my Laverne Spencer Drive, and I have achieved a lot for the country, so I think it's probably something well deserved and hopefully it can be achieved or realized.
St. Lucia had never won gold at the Games, even though it had been sending athletes since 1962 and consistently from 1994. Spencer came close to breaking the country's gold medal duck twice before, but finally did so this year. The local hero leaves the island on Tuesday for the US to continue training as she prepares for her next competition, the Drake Relays, on the 28th of April 2018. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The National Olympic Committee presented a check for $10,000 to high jump star Laverne Spencer in recognition of her achievement at the recently concluded Commonwealth Games. We hear more in this report.
In her touching remarks, Ms. Spencer admitted that the road to success has not been easy. She recalled times when she was overwhelmed by the challenges and felt like throwing in the towel. She faced criticism, some of which was constructive, but this brought out the best in her.
Even when at times I have been criticized for not meeting your expectations, I have looked at it as you wanted me to be the best. And so I have used this criticism as a stepping stone in my quest to get to the top.
The National Olympic Committee presented a check for $10,000 to the high jump star in recognition of her achievement. Despite being 33 years of age, President of the Committee, Fortuna Belrose, believes that Ms. Spencer still has what it takes to continue representing St. Lucia at the highest level.
And from what we've seen, Laverne still has a belly of fire inside of her. And we just trust that she can continue to perform and the good Lord can grant her the strength, the courage and the health to be number one in the world. Not just the Commonwealth, but the world.
Acting Prime Minister Stevenson King signaled the government's renewed commitment to providing future support to Ms. Spencer in her quest for excellence.
Let me therefore assure Laverne that the government will continue to give the necessary support where needed to ensure that you in your career continue to excel and continue to bring gold to St. Lucia to make St. Lucians even prouder than they are this afternoon.
The check presentation took place at the Derek Walcott Square. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And Commonwealth Games gold medalist Laverne Spencer has urged local authorities to invest more in sports as one way of keeping young people away from crime. Spencer believes authorities are not doing enough to develop sports in St. Lucia. Sheffield Gillard has that story.
Spencer believes there are a number of talented young people who, if given support, can excel as she did. She says there needs to be programs put in place to keep the young people engaged in different sports that will not only take them off the streets, but also enhance their skills.
I think to highlight the talented people in St. Lucia, not even those in ghettos, but I think you need to spend in order to get. And I've always said that, you know, there are a lot of coaches overseas, you know, even in the U.S., a lot of coaches ask me, you know, can we come to St. Lucia and have camps or anything like that? But you need to spend in order to get. So if they spend, like, you know, bring the coaches down to St. Lucia, have a couple of camps, you know, we could, the athletes could really benefit from that. And I think, you know, that's one step in recognizing talent and probably, you know, you never know, they probably could get a scholarship later on in life and the coaches could recognize something in them.
She made reference to the deplorable condition of the island's sporting facilities, including the George Odlam Stadium, which is currently being used as a makeshift hospital.
Our facility is not the best. Maybe that's one setback, you know, that's why we're not progressing as much as we want to. I know the stadium is not in the best shape, but any little thing helps, you know. They could probably do it at Bossiju or, but I just think, you know, they need to invest a little more into sports and hopefully, you know, that could benefit the younger athletes coming up.
Spencer made the comments during a press conference hosted by her main sponsor, Flo.
This is our longest standing, sponsorship agreement. We didn't see it as such, and Mr. Dixon probably has a half smile now because, you know, there were times when the, you know, going was tough, both for Laverne and even in terms of our continuous investment. But we're very happy that we stuck by her side. We know that over the last 24 hours and maybe the next 2 months, 3 months, you know, she will be receiving overtures from all corners. But we are confident because our motive and our interest in Laverne is one that's genuine and long-standing. We see her as a national symbol, a national icon for us, and it's Kevin Wallace / Flo's exceeding pleasure to be a part of the relationship.
The company has been sponsoring Laverne for over 10 years. Spencer was handed a bouquet of flowers, along with the latest Samsung Galaxy S9 smartphone, inclusive of a data package, which will allow her to keep in touch with friends and family while competing overseas. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, a long-standing CSA member vying to become CSA president has reiterated the need to separate party politics from the organization's affairs. The comments come ahead of Wednesday's trade union elections, and just as government and the CSA are preparing to go to the bargaining table to commence a new round of negotiations. Don Nicholas reports.
Rogja has been a CSA member since 1984. Under the last executive, he served as a negotiator. As a candidate vying for CSA president, he stressed the need for political neutrality when it comes to conducting the association's business. Party politics, he says, must be left out.
I think we should try to leave the politics, and that is the party politics, that is, out of it. But the organizational politics is okay because people are free to choose which side that they want to support within the CSA itself.
Mr. Jack expressed a disappointment with what he says is the failure of past executives to consult with members ahead of negotiations.
I think the process should involve that. There should be some sort of consultation with the members because after all, you're representing the members. So there should be a consultation going in. Thereafter, as a negotiating team on behalf of the CSA, you now go and meet the employer's negotiating team.
Worker productivity is another burning issue. Mr. Zhe admits that some departments are plagued by a lack of it, but he says there are root causes like health and safety hazards at the workplace and the lack of opportunities for promotion because persons outside the public service are called in to hold key positions in government. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
And now this. NEMO has partnered with international counterparts to expand the training in hazardous materials response to include community personnel. The objective is to have certified first responders from various communities. Don Nicholas has the details.
The National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO, the United States Agency for International Development, USAID, and the Office of U.S. Foreign Disaster Assistance, OFDA, organized a workshop in St. Lucia on hazardous materials response. With 141 million registered chemicals in the world, coordinators deem it important that first responders be equipped with the technical skills to save lives in the event of an emergency. Numerous organizations, including community-based institutions, took part in the training session. Upon completion, the participants are expected to be certified.
They also be able to identify, recognize what it is we are dealing with, and using key tools like the emergency response guide to be able to start the initial actions to save lives and properties.
Instructors say the training cannot be confined to the police and the fire service. They say training for community representatives is critical since in most emergency situations, they are the first responders. One of the instructors explained the benefits of the program.
I used to see the ERG, that is the book, we use the Bible of this course. I used to see it on our fire plans and I used to wonder, what is it for or how am I supposed to use it? I used to flip through it, but I wasn't sure. But through participating in this program, first as a participant and now I'm here, my second time as an instructor, it has given me, I'm more confident when I respond to an incident, when I have this book, I'm more confident that I'll be able to save and protect more lives and the environment.
The participants are calling for more programs of this nature. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. A plane crashed. Every single person on board died except two persons. Why didn't these two die?
So that means the plane didn't have nobody on it, eh? It had on it?
Yeah.
And
every single person died except two people. Mm-hmm. These two didn't die, but we want to know why they didn't die.
Maybe both of them was God, they didn't die.
Okay.
Because that's what I could say. Because if the plane had plenty of people and two didn't die, mm-hmm. and
couldn't they just be lucky?
They was lucky. They was lucky. Maybe the people that was on it, it was God.
The aircraft that brought the people that took up the people from Brazil that was going to Venezuela. Mm-hmm. Out of 70 something person that was on board the aircraft, only six people had survived. So it's according to the place where they was. I feel there was in the tail. That's why. You understand?
Yeah.
But 70 something got they lose their lives.
Yeah.
And six survived.
Because where they were?
In the tail of the airplane.
Okay.
So you know what happened there?
Mm-hmm.
Where the plane blew up,
yeah.
if it's in the air or where it fall.
Yeah.
But sometimes when a plane crash, everybody will die. But sometimes you may get one person or two person that will survive.
A plane crash.
Every single person.
Every single person on the plane crash but die,
excepting
two.
Yes.
A plane crash. Everybody on board die, excepting two. That one is a hard one, eh? Trust me. Yeah, it hard, eh? I can't go further.
Okay.
I good for the time.
Yeah.
Maybe they believe in God because they have Jesus in their life. Yes.
You strongly believe that?
Yes.
The time didn't come yet for them to die.
It wasn't their time yet?
Yeah. That's the way I think.
That's the way you think?
Yeah.
It wasn't their time?
It wasn't their time to die. That's why the both of them
survived.
Because they believe in God.
When you believe in God, you are dying so.
You are dying so. You're living longer. And the way you take care of your body too.
Yeah.
That is how I know it.
So that's why they
die? That is why they die.
Take care of the body.
Not really take care of the body. I mean, you check it, come to the point. You check why?
Maybe God protect them.
That's how you see it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because maybe they God children.
Yeah, God children.
Yes.
A plane crashed. Every single person on board died, except two persons. Why didn't these two die? Because they were married. What is your marital status? Single or married? They were married. Every single person died. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Busquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, Victoria Hospital staff begin moving in to the Owen King EU Hospital and a call for local politicians to clean up their act. Welcome back and thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The Ministry of Health continues the steady transitioning of the Victoria Hospital to the Owen King EU Hospital. Over the past few days, staff of the health institution have been engaged in the physical relocation of the outpatient unit at VH to OKEUH. However, some outpatient services will still remain at the Victoria Hospital. Glenn Simon reports.
Clients of the outpatient clinic at the Victoria Hospital were informed of the closure of this unit from Wednesday, 18th April, to facilitate its relocation to the Owen King EU Hospital. The executive director at the Victoria Hospital, Brenda Calix, said it requires an enormous amount of planning and strategizing to move any section of an active hospital, such as VH, particularly the outpatient clinic, which is heavily utilized. She, however, assured clients of the imminent reopening of the outpatient clinic at the OKEU Hospital.
On Monday, April 23rd, we begin our operations of the outpatient clinic at the OKEU Hospital.
Calix explained that since not all hospital services have transitioned to the OKEU Hospital, outpatient clients are required to work with certain requested information when coming to the clinic.
Clients coming to the outpatient clinic need to carry their identification cards and if they have any x-rays or ultrasounds to take to the clinic, they need to get them done at least a day or two before coming to the clinic. These services are still available at Victoria Hospital, so clients can get that done at Victoria Hospital before they come to the clinic. Also, we are asking that they take with them the identification cards because we will be registering persons. And to ensure that we do not have any errors, persons need to have their ID cards to be able to present their ID cards so that we can do proper registration of clients.
Clients are also required to carry with them the results of any blood tests recently done. Oncology and echocardiogram clinics will remain at the Victoria Hospital and are not among the outpatient services transferred during this move. The executive director also indicated that transportation arrangements have been put in place with the assistance of the Ministry of Infrastructure for clients to get to the facility.
Transportation has been arranged for persons coming to the outpatient clinic at OKEU from the Derek Walcott Square.
Hospital officials apologized for any inconvenience caused to their many clients as they seek to improve service delivery in a more spacious and comfortable environment. For the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Glenn Simon reporting.
St. Lucia may soon benefit from the East Caribbean Flour Mill Foundation set up to assist needy persons in the areas of health and education. The foundation is currently supporting individuals in neighboring St. Vincent and the Grenadines. More from Miguel Morissette.
East Caribbean Flour Mills, also known as ECGC, came to St. Lucia's shores with the aim of creating an ECGC foundation which will support and enhance the lives of St. Lucians in the health and education sectors. The ECGC is currently based in St. Vincent and has been in operation for over 40 years as the producers of flour, animal feeds, rice and beverages. On Wednesday, April 18, 2018, The CEO of East Caribbean Flour Mills, Osman Devi, met with key stakeholders to dialogue and discuss the way forward in the development of the foundation.
In St. Vincent, we have been giving support to the community college and the UV Open Campus, assisting students who are needy in terms of books and form of tuition. And from the health perspective, needy folks who need medical attention but just cannot afford it, we would make a contribution to that particular cause. Well, the overall center is quite similar. That's why today we're speaking with the community college, the department, the National Community Foundation, the Ministry of Health, to give an idea of what the foundation does and how we can partner with the three groups in St. Lucia, or if we can have one group that we partner with and they'll be responsible for doing the necessary disbursements.
Davy explains how the foundation will be sustained.
The 10 cents per bag is based on the number of bags of products that is sold per year. That money flows through to the foundation. Also, the directors of the company, the board of directors, members have agreed and they make their directors' fees available to the foundation on an annual basis. That may be around, it's a substantial amount of money in terms, you know. We also obtain funds from suppliers of grains. They would give us so many tons of wheat or corn or soya, which will be converted into finished products. The proceeds from the sale of those finished products flow back to the foundation to sustain the cost and the development.
Meanwhile, Minister for Health and Wellness, Senator the Honorable Mary Isaac, has described the initiative as phenomenal and beneficial.
I think it is wonderful when we have partners coming on board to assist us to take care of our children, to take care of our students, our people, to make a contribution towards the healthcare sector. So it is a very welcome initiative, this foundation that we are looking at joining. It is set up by ECGC. Of course, we know that ECGC has always been a very good partner with the government of St. Lucia. And they have always contributed to the well-being of people in society. So this is quite a welcome initiative for us.
Following the establishment of the foundation in St. Lucia, it is the intention of the ECGC to extend similar support to Antigua and Dominica. For the Ministry of Health and Wellness, I am Miguel Morissette.
The U.S.-based WellStar Population Health Organization, run by St. Lucian-born Virginia Wolf, donated a large quantity of goods to the Social Justice Ministry for the island's caregivers program today. Officials say senior citizens under the program will benefit immensely. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Virginia Wolf is originally from Marsha Castries. She now lives in the United States. Mrs. Wolf, a registered nurse, is the leader of U.S.-based WellStar Population Health Organization. She says she has always been passionate about assisting the elderly. On Friday, her organization donated a large quantity of goods to the Social Justice Ministry for the country's caregivers program.
Definitely, this is not the first. I have two barrels on my job. That one is almost full. And we're going to get these barrels here to the seniors, to the people. And I want to really say kudos to the government.
As she expressed gratitude on behalf of the government, Minister in the Ministry of Social Justice, Fortuna Bellrose, called on more of the St. Lucian diaspora in the various countries around the world to follow Mrs. Wolf's example.
We're quite happy for her decision to be able to do this. And we want to thank them most sincerely for the support that they've given us. What we would also like to see is that level of support and philanthropy, being extended across the diaspora.
The WellStar Population Health Organization is also raising funds to assist three children in the Seventh-day Adventist Academy with their schooling. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
A former St. Lucian Prime Minister says politicians should deal with the issues rather than to continue taking personal jabs at each other. Mr. Stevenson King, who this week celebrated 31 years in active politics, says politics has changed significantly from when he began his career. Here is Sheffield Gillard with the details.
Parliamentarians have been criticized for their conduct in the House and have been called upon to stop the personal attacks against each other. Not only have they been accused of not setting an example for the younger generation, but have also been called out for disrespecting the constituents who voted them into office with the behavior.
Back then in 1982-87, coming up, it was a period when, while there seemed to have been much political banter, there was an understanding that we were all vying for the same purpose, the same cause. We're fighting for the same cause, the cause that needed our assistance. And that cause was about the people. And so in Parliament, we went fiercely after each other, but in a very mature way, dealing with the issues rather than being too personal. I don't believe in this personal attack in Parliament or otherwise. I believe we need to deal with the issues. We can challenge our opponents on their policies, on their philosophy, their principles, in the manner in which they attempt to provide to the people. But we must never, ever attempt to destroy families and individuals who make such great sacrifice for the people.
Mr. King believes it is time that politicians see that personal political attacks don't advance their causes, and instead they need to come together for the advancement of the country.
I see a different attitude, a different view. I see a lot of divisiveness in our country. Our country needs healing, our country needs uniting. Our people need to understand that we're all brothers and sisters, and we are in a world in which no one seem to care about us. The great United States speaks about America first, yet still we are destroying each other in this country. So we need to understand that and to begin to be St. Lucian, true St. Lucian, and to do things St. Lucian, and at the same time to protect what is ours and to ensure that each and every St. Lucian has a contribution to make, that they're given that opportunity to make the contribution, and that they're able to access the opportunities that are there and to explore the great possibilities that lies ahead.
Stevenson King entered active politics in 1987 and became St. Lucia's sixth Prime Minister in September 2007 following the death of Sir John Compton. King represents a constituency of Castries North, which he successfully represented for most of his political career.
It has been a long journey, one of tremendous challenge and yet successes, one of service, which I believe in, and one when I look back, I can, to a great extent, be comforted by the fact that my work in the vineyard of the people has produced quite a bit over the years. I have served for 31 years, or rather I've been involved in the elective politics for 31 years. I've seen many come and go. I've seen some who have disappeared. But I've remained focused on the task at hand. That is the mission to serve the people, to create a better way of life, a higher standard of living, a better quality of life, and at all times to seek greater opportunity for the people, in as far as their personal advancement is concerned.
Mr. King held a number of portfolios, including health, labor relations, sports, finance, and most recently infrastructure. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
When we come back in just a moment, the Center for Adolescent Renewal and Education celebrates 25 years. The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture has organized a two-day seminar to help companies boost their sales at a time when many companies are grappling with economic challenges. Don Nicholas reports.
Francis Lewis was retained by the St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce, Industry and Agriculture to conduct a training seminar aimed at strengthening the sales capacity of businesses. The two-day program looked at practical approaches that participants can use at their establishments. Sales management, according to Mr. Lewis, is the heartbeat of a company, and struggling economies can provide the impetus for salespersons to develop their skills.
If I have a sailing boat, if the wind is to my back, that's great, because it'll blow me where I want to go. If the wind is not to my back, then I have to learn how to tack, and that is where I need skill.
Several institutions were represented at Friday's exercise. Banks, food and beverage companies, and media houses were all in attendance.
We had businesses there. We had a bank. We had a couple distribution companies. We had a number of companies in other industries. And what we tried to do is come up with very practical ways of carrying forward so that they can get commercial success.
The seminar is being held at the Bay Gardens Hotel. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
We continue the broadcast with news that the Center for Adolescent Renewal and Education, or CARE, today held an exhibition at the Castries City Hall. The exhibition is part of a month of activities in commemoration of the center's 25th anniversary. We hear more in this Alex Boske report.
The exhibition highlighted the center's work with marginalized and at-risk youth and the various programs through which it helps them become productive citizens.
We have our core areas of the program, which is the self-awareness program, the spirituality, public speaking, parenting, and we also have our social studies corner. So that's our core areas of the program. And we have the various skills departments being depicted here. We also have our arts and craft corner. We have electrical small appliance repair, electrical air conditioning and refrigeration, carpentry and joinery, auto mechanics, office and computer skills, and catering and hospitality.
The first year of the three-year program focuses totally on the development of young people.
And for this, we do the SPICES program, where we try to, they are developed spiritually, physically, intellectually, creatively, emotionally, and socially. So that takes care of the entire human body. And after we have molded these young individuals and prepared them to face the challenges out there, then they move into the skills component of the program, which lasts for 2 years. For those who are more mature and older, the skills program runs for 1 year. And towards the end of the program in May, they go on internship for 8 weeks. And this is where most of them gain employment.
The Center for Adolescent Renewal and Education has contributed significantly to the development of young people in today's society.
We have been trying everything that we possibly can. So right now we are just depending on God to do what He feels is best for us and to lead us in the right direction, to the right individuals, to the right organizations to try to help us.
Having four centers scattered across the island poses a great challenge for the learning institution.
CARE have contributed significantly because I have been with the organization for 25 years. I'm celebrating my anniversary this year, actually. We have really contributed to the young people of St. Lucia by molding them and shaping them, building positive attitudes to work-related situations and life in general. The business places have been pleased with our young people because of the positive attitude that they come in with. And they have said time and time again, they can train a young person if they have a positive attitude. But if you don't have a positive attitude, you are not trainable. So I think we have made a lot of contributions. Thousands of young people have graduated from CARE and they are doing well. We have police officers in our midst. We have firemen. We have people who work in the bank sector. We have on every single hotel in the island. We have those. We have past students who are present working towards their law degree. We have those who are builders. We have media, those in the media sector. We have those who have their own mechanic shops, their own carpentry and joinery shop, their own electrical business, their own salons. So they are all over the place. We have trainees who are overseas who are running their own businesses also.
The theme for this year's celebration is 25 years, harnessing the potential of our youth. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
The Cultural Development Foundation, CDF, in collaboration with the events company St. Lucia Incorporated, are embarking on a music industry symposium. The two-day event will take place on April 27th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. and noon to 4 p.m. on the 28th at the Dolphin Conference Center at the Bay Gardens Resort. The symposium aims to create linkages between local producers and artists and international pairs.
So the person's coming down, Miss Tracy Hamlin. She is an international recording artist. We have Stephanie Thomas, who is an entertainment attorney. Crystal Bozeman, who is basically founder and president of the Shazier Enterprises. and she is also the manager for singer and actress Maya and Tracy Braxton. And we also have Ellis Perry, who is a music producer for Kindred and the Family, As I said, it's a two-day workshop, and the setup is going to look at things like the business of music, copyrights, vocal training. Contract agreements, you know, things of the sort. And it's supposed to be, you know, they're supposed to have four breakout sessions. The vocal training in particular, we are asking the artisans who are going to participate to come at least with a song ready or something that they could present so that they could be assisted in terms of looking at how they could strengthen their work, their productions, their presentations.
Organizers also hope to help artists to further develop their work in an attempt to tap into the international market. The National Youth Council NYC, along with the Department of Youth and Sports, hosted the National Youth Festival 2018. Alex Buske has a report.
The National Youth Festival is split into two parts.
We have the first part, which is on-stage activity, where young persons would be coming to display their various talents, whether it is dance, drama, art, spoken word, or singing. And we have a youth exhibition where many of our young entrepreneurs have come out to display their business, whether it is craft making or designing or photography. We have all our young entrepreneurs here today for us to display their talents.
Despite challenges in obtaining the necessary funding to facilitate the project, the chairperson of the National Youth Festival Project Committee says the council is thankful for whatever they got.
We truly appreciate and thank all our corporate entities and the government for liaising with us to bring forth this activity. We are very comfortable with what we've put on today. We know we did our best, and we were given different elements. We were given tents via CCC, we were given tents by a GDCL, we were given tents from back of St. Lucia. We also got funding from the ministry. So we're quite much satisfied with what we got here today and what we have put on for the public here today.
The young entrepreneurs came out in numbers displaying their products, some of which are quite unique.
On display here today, we have Ifani's Designs, we have She Naturals Caribbean, we have Ali, Makeup with Ali, we have Mind of Xavier. All of these are young brands. Also, we have Tizuk Bags and Heart of Anarchy. All these are young brands who are just coming out, young persons with businesses and entities.
Noticing the high rate of unemployment, Ms. Montout says this festival will encourage young persons to strive towards self-employment.
We, the National Youth Council, are aware that our unemployment figures amongst youth are still very high, and this is why we're starting to engage in different activities to bring out the entrepreneurship skills of our young people. Last year, we hosted our Youth Entrepreneurship Seminar, which was in November, and we also hosted Youth Expo, which was another exhibition of young entrepreneurs to come out and display their talent, and now we're having Youth Festival again to encourage the young entrepreneurs and to give them some exposure to the public. And also to tell young people that, you know, there is avenues, and show the other young persons who are coming here today that there are other avenues than to just wait for a job.
The National Youth Festival 2018 took place at the Derek Walcott Square on Friday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busque.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Kenson Casimir. You're just in time for the usual reminder. A proposal to rename the Urinora International Airport after Laverne Spencer in honor of a gold medal win at the Commonwealth Games. A call for politics to be left out of trade union affairs as the CSA gets set to elect a new executive. The Ministry of Health continues the steady transitioning of the Victoria Hospital to the Owen King EU Hospital. And a former Prime Minister challenges politicians to put nation building ahead of scoring political points. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night and see you next time.